This episode of the podcast is brought to you by New Bloom Labs.
Delta 8, it's been the boom and the trend in most non-adult use states. But did you know that many Delta 8 products have significant quantities of Delta 9 in them as well? This is because most cannabis labs have a hard time accurately analyzing Delta 8, but not New Bloom Labs. New Bloom Labs delivers clear, precise chromatography of Delta 8 products. They also lead the industry with potency testing of Delta 9 and two isomers of Delta 10 and a dozen other major and minor cannabinoids that are shaping the industry. New Bloom Labs also provides a secure client portal that allows producers to access their COAs 24/7 and download QR codes for their product labels. If you've ever questioned your lab's potency reports of Delta 8 products, call New Bloom Labs at 844-TEST-CBD or visit their website at newbloomlabs.com. Superior science, rapid results, New Bloom Labs.
This episode of the podcast is brought to you by Branding Isolate.
Hey, my fellow people of the plant, Kevin here, and I want to share my recent experience hiring Elena and the Branding Isolate team to help me update Cannabinoid Connect's logo. They made the process super easy and efficient by first meeting with me to learn about the origin story of the Cannabinoid Connect brand, then using that information to inform the updated logo's design. The branding agency is comprised of professional designers and developers who have over two decades of experience in design, branding, and web development services. Whether you're a new CBD business looking for branding or a new website, or if you're an existing business that's just looking to update your current branding, I recommend you call the team at Branding Isolate. Their number is 832-379-8978, or you can visit their website at brandingisolate.com. Branding Isolate, the branding agency that handcrafts brands that sell, connect, and succeed. Hello, my fellow people of the plant. Thanks for tuning in to another episode of the Cannabinoid Connect podcast, your favorite podcast that includes industry-facing conversations with the industry's leading experts that aim to educate and inform the public regarding the plant's endless benefits. My guest today is Natalie Siracusa. She's the Chief Science Officer and Laboratory Director at New Bloom Labs. Hello, Natalie. Thanks for joining me this morning.
Hello, Kevin. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Yes. You mentioned that you're out in Chattanooga, right?
Chattanooga, East Tennessee.
East Tennessee. And it's rainy. It's rainy and dreary, just like it is here in Dallas, Texas. So we're all preparing for that cold front, that freeze that's coming in.
It's headed this way. It's in West Tennessee now and headed straight for us.
Well, make sure you stay inside and stay dry out there. But thanks for joining again today. For those listening, as I mentioned, I have Natalie Siracusa on. She's the Chief Science Officer and Laboratory Director at New Bloom Labs. So Natalie, I'm excited to talk with you today because, you know, we're really going to dive into this topic of Delta 8, right? And we've talked about it a lot on this podcast previously. I had Rod Kite on from the legal perspective to talk about Delta 8. And what he's seeing there. And so I'm excited to talk to you today about Delta 8 from the lab testing perspective, right? The challenges, the opportunities and best practices and so on. So before we dive into all that, let's allow the audience to get a sense of who you are. So tell us a little bit about your background and what led you to the cannabis industry.
Well, I was born and raised in Memphis, Tennessee. I received my undergraduate there from Christian Brothers University. And then I moved on to Birmingham, Alabama to UAB and received my master's in forensics there. So my education and training is in forensics, and that's where I began in the laboratory industry. I then moved from forensics into toxicology and served as the resident toxicologist and chief operating officer of a toxicology and clinical operation in Memphis, Tennessee. Moved on from there here into the cannabis world. John and I met in February of 2018, and we shared the common interests and decided that we wanted to serve the community. There was a huge need, especially here in Tennessee, where, you know, great place to grow cannabis. There was a huge need for some solid analytics. And you know, John's, you know, really good at reaching the community. And, you know, I had the laboratory skill set to help him with that. And so here we are 2 years later.
Yeah, and I know that y'all have expanded outside of Tennessee now into Texas also. You're serving the Texas market, which is great. So tell me first, before I want to dive more into that, let's talk about the differences between your experience working in forensics and toxicology and then now into cannabis. Like, what are the differences? I bet it's like night and day.
Well, it's really not from a laboratory perspective. Now, from you know, the far away perspective, it's like, wow, you moved from law enforcement and, you know, patient testing into cannabis. Oh my gosh, you know. But, you know, at the end of the day, from a technical and scientific perspective, analytical laboratory science is where my skill set lies, the analysis of unknowns, and for a number of reasons, whether it's for law enforcement, whether it's for compliance, whether it's for patients and their, you know, well-being or whatever. You know, at the end of the day, it's just laboratory analytics for me. So what I will say is that the, you know, client consultations has always been a big part of my job. And, you know, it has changed over time as I have moved from one side of the lab industry to another. So I began consulting with attorneys and law enforcement, and then I moved into, you know, consulting with physicians and nurse practitioners and doctors. And now I am literally consulting with growers and, you know, processors. And so it's been a journey, and it's been great. And, you know, my background in the forensic and patient testing realm has served me and made me the scientist that I am today. And I truly believe that it helps even in the cannabis industry.
Yeah. I like the way you put it. Like, your job is to basically like discover the unknowns or learn the unknowns. Right. And that strikes so true when you think about cannabis, because of how we're barely scratching the surface when it comes to what we're learning about, you know, these cannabinoids and these secondary compounds, you know, flavonoids, terpenes, things like that. So every day, I would imagine in your space as a scientist, you're just like, it's just kind of fascinating, right?
It's ongoing. And it's, you know, and as a laboratory scientist, the golden rule, the most important rule that, you know, a laboratory scientist should follow is that everything that crosses the threshold is an unknown, and it's to be treated unbiased and with heavy quality control and scrutiny. And that's the way that we operate here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's great. So you talked about how you transitioned into cannabis. You're in Tennessee. You talked with John Kearns, who is the owner and CEO. So you said that there was that need, right, for lab testing. And I like that you said that, because right now, as we know, on the hemp side, since the 2018 Farm Bill was passed, there's really no regulatory compliance when it comes, like, mandated compliance, right? At the state level, of course, there is, but talk a little bit about that need and kind of how you guys are positioned to help serve that problem.
It is a problem. And I'm glad you said it first. So I don't mind, you know, coming in behind you. It is a problem. You know, it's not my first time working in a sector of the lab industry in its infancy. The cannabis lab industry, even though there's labs that have been around for a while, at the end of the day, it's still in its infancy. It takes time for industries like this to grow and build. And I've worked in sectors of the lab industry in the past that were in their infancy. The difference is that, you know, they were government regulated even from the very beginning. You know, forensics and patient testing, both, you know, government regulated from the very beginning. And this industry, on the other hand, not. There are no regulations. There's nothing out there. And what we see with that is a struggle to understand what everybody needs to be doing. And more importantly, the community, the growers and the processors, are struggling to know what's right and what's wrong. And unfortunately, I can't tell them that either. I wish that I could. So, you know, the goal needs to be more unified policy and guidelines. And that's going to have to come at the federal level, I think. But, you know, at this point in time, you know, the feds aren't really wanting to touch this right now.
Mm-hmm. Well, and you know, I'll say, you know, I'm the one who said it first, that it's a problem, right? So let's talk about like some of the specific problems that we're currently seeing. And it's been echoed on this podcast. You're not going to be the first to say, you know, the term lab shopping, right? Trying to get higher potency levels than what you normally would for your crop, or, you know, you know, bad practices within the lab or outdated equipment. So like, what else, like, or, you know, let's dive into some of those. And what are you seeing?
Well, you know, again, in knowing about my background, this whole lab shopping situation, I just don't have any words for it. It's a real shame. What, you know, the term lab shopping and target reporting also comes into that. Essentially, is at this point in time in the industry, because there are no regulations, clients have the opportunity to literally buy the COA that they want. You know, growers and processors are spending a lot of money and investing a lot of money into their grows and into their businesses. And the whole point of laboratory testing is to show them what they're producing with unbiased and with quality. Unfortunately, because so much has been invested, when a client doesn't necessarily like the analytics that they're getting, they have the opportunity to go and find another lab that will give them the analytics. There's a lot of levels of this going on. I think that, you know, there are labs that are knowingly, you know, handing out COAs that the clients want. I think that there are labs unknowingly handing out bad analytics just due to, you know, maybe a lack of expertise within the laboratory on how to truly validate a method and be accurate and be under quality control. And I think that there are labs also not only just knowingly doing it, but they're doing it to maintain client relationships and to make money. And, you know, it's an issue. It's an issue. And more importantly, for those of us that do not target report, that do not, you know, allow clients to buy COAs, that operate under, you know, ISO and DEA and quality control and precision and accuracy, it makes our life a lot harder.
Right. Right. And you mentioned like the change really needs to happen at the federal level when it comes to implementing this regulation, right? So I would imagine, though, there needs to be like a collaboration effort here, right? Because the federal government probably doesn't have the know-all and expertise in this area. So it would be beneficial for both sides of the aisle to kind of work together to implement this regulation. Would you agree?
I 100% agree. And this is something that John and I have talked about, you know, exhaustively since day one. I would love for whoever at the federal level to approach me and say, would you be willing to hand over your analytics and so that we have some information and whatever. And, you know, that's always on the table for us. We want to help out, you know, because you know, we want regulation coming in. You know, it's important. It's important that everybody knows what to do and how and when. And with more regulation comes, you know, more sophistication in the industry.
I've heard that Michigan is kind of a great example of that collaborative effort between, you know, the operators and the policymakers. You know, I'm not sure if you've heard the same or if there's other states that you would kind of look at as a good example, but Michigan's one that I've heard.
Well, you know, I think that there's several states out there that are working towards that and that get it a little more right than others, right? Yeah. But you know, we're a part of that community and we are lobbying for all of this and we'll continue to do so.
Yeah, no, it's definitely something that's needed. You know, because there's a lot of people lose at the end of the day, right? You've got the good actors that are trying to do the right thing and just losing out because they're operating accordingly. And then you've got consumers who are just, you know, consuming bad products that are either harmful or contain no CBD or minor cannabinoids in it, you know? So it's good that y'all are focusing on that. So Natalie, let's turn our attention and talk about Delta 8 now. Dun, 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 Delta 8. So let's set the stage first. I mean, we've talked about it a lot in this podcast, but maybe for those that are just tuning in, let's set the stage and why don't you talk about what it is and why it's so popular in non-adult use states at the moment.
Well, so Delta 8 is a synthetic cannabinoid. It's a conversion product. It's you know, so Delta 9 THC, this is essentially a cousin or a brother or whatever you would like to say about it. So the only difference in Delta 8 and Delta 9 in the chemistry is where the double bond lies in the actual molecular ring of that structure. So they weigh the same, they look the same, all of that, but there's a hydrogen that is moved in that ring. And so Delta 8 has become popular in the non-adult use states or the hemp industry because, you know, the community has approached it as a loophole around Delta 9, right? So Delta 8 specifically is not scheduled under the Controlled Substance Act. Delta 9 is. So I think the goal in the community with this emergence of Delta 8, again, was just to get around the Delta 9 situation, to be able to give a THC cannabinoid out to the community legally, I guess.
Yeah. So follow-up question with that. Okay, because I'm starting to dial it in terms of understanding Delta 8 more and more as I'm having these conversations. So to repeat what you said, you're saying that it's a conversion process where you're extracting whatever Delta 9 THC you can get from a hemp-derived plant, which is 0.3 or less, but they're also extracting CBD and they're converting that CBD into Delta 8.
That's correct.
And here's my question, okay? Because I've heard two sides. I've heard, because you said synthetic, and I've heard it's that conversion process can either be synthetic or it can be a natural process. Is that true?
Well, conversion of cannabinoids under the right stressors can absolutely be natural. At the end of the day, conversion of cannabinoids requires stressors. Okay, so heat, light, organic solvents, all of those things. So yeah, I mean, if you stick a cannabis crop under enough light and enough heat for enough time, you can definitely convert. But Delta 8 is not really naturally occurring or produced by, you know, the hemp crop. It can be converted into that under the right stress or the right cultivation. But it's, you know, I've seen Delta 8 a handful of times in actual flower and at a very low level. So it's obvious that it was converted during cultivation, during the grow. But it does not exist in nature. It's synthetic. It's a conversion product.
Conversion product, that loophole that you talked about. Yeah. So what challenges does Delta 8 present, like from your perspective, the lab testing perspective?
Well, I think the biggest challenge out there, I want to start out with this because I think it's important. It's an important statement to make to the community. Organic chemistry is never clean. It's not perfect. It's never clean. You can predict a lot of things in organic chemistry, but you can't predict everything. So, you know, the challenges that we're seeing on the lab side of things in the Delta 8 industry is that a lot of the Delta 8 intermediates, so when I say intermediate, I mean like a distillate, for example, which a distillate can also go into a vape cartridge as well. I mean, most vapes are distillates. So sometimes an intermediate, sometimes not. But most of the Delta 8 distillates that we're seeing are not compliant. And the community...
How so? With like pesticides and...
Oh, no, with Delta 9. So,
oh, I see.
Right. So the Delta 8 distillates that we're seeing are greater than 0.3%. on the Delta 9 side of things, and in fact, they're much higher than that. And the
like
community,
how much higher?
Well, you know, I think the cleanest I've seen Well, I don't want to give out a bunch of numbers. I really don't want to give out any of the analytics. So I'm going to keep that to myself.
All right.
It's high. It's high. And, you know, the community is struggling with this. They're absolutely struggling with this. Mostly because, you know, they want a compliant product straight after distillation, and they want to throw it in a vape cartridge and get at it. But more importantly, I think the main reason that the community is struggling with this is because there is a huge variance in the laboratory analytics on these products. Some labs are showing the Delta 9, some labs are not. So the community is struggling to figure out who's right and who's wrong.
When you say showing, like are they misreporting it, like changing the number, or are they just not flat out, they're just not reporting the number?
I can't attest to why or what a lot of these labs are doing, but we have conducted a lot of internal investigations on this matter over the last 10 months. I've spent a lot of time on this.
And these findings, are they both in, like, are they kind of primarily in Tennessee or Texas, or, you know, both states, or nationwide? Like where
nationwide. Absolutely nationwide. I think there's a lot of reasons why there's variation between labs on the Delta 8 situation. We talked about target reporting earlier. I believe that that's part of, you know, the reason why there's variation. We also talked about earlier, you know, poorly validated and developed methods that can't resolve these cannabinoids. So I think that that's part of it too. So, you know, at the end of the day, it's a combination of things, I think, but I can't attest to that. That's just an opinion.
Got you. So what are y'all doing? What is New Bloom Labs doing when it comes to Delta 8 analysis? We'll start there.
Well, you know, we feel good always about the analytics that we're publishing here. I would absolutely not publish a lab report with my signature on it if I didn't feel good about the analytics and didn't feel that I couldn't attest to them and testify to them in a court of law if I needed to, which is where my background and training comes from in forensics. So that's how I operate. The way that New Bloom has approached this Delta 8 conundrum is by running extensive audits, experiments, and essentially trying to squash the myths is what we're doing. Because, you know, things are always going to emerge in the laboratory industry, and method evaluation should be ongoing. And it's required in my laboratory. It's in my SOPs. If any new interferences or possibilities are emerging in the industry, we are required here at New Bloom to test that theory and to make sure that we are not reporting false positives and negatives on our assays. Because that's the goal in any method validation. When you validate a method, when you put a method together, you evaluate that method in depth and extensively before you begin publishing that method. And what you're evaluating is, am I turning out everything that's real and true? The goal is no false positives, no false negatives. So you never want to publish anything that you don't feel comfortable that you're not reporting a false positive or false negative on. So that's where the method evaluation comes from. So we've had clients that approach us, well, you know, you're reporting Delta 9 and it's actually HU331. Okay, well, you know, we ran interference on that, squashed, you know, no problem. Well, you know, you're actually reporting Delta 10 as a false positive. It's Delta 10 that you're doing. That's the Delta 9 that you're reporting. Okay, well, I now publish Delta 10 on my lab report. That's how well I can resolve the THC cannabinoids. We publish Delta 8, Delta 9, and the isomers of Delta 10. So not only can I see Delta 10, I can actually separate the mirror images of Delta 10. So we squash that and are publishing that. Well, you know, you're reporting a false positive for THCP. Okay, brought that standard in, ran an interference study on that. Not happening. You know, so it's ongoing. It's all the time. And so we have run all of these interference studies, published them in our SOPs. We're now publishing Delta 10 on every lab report, you know, and just continuing, and that's ongoing. It's all the time. So we love it, frankly, when the community approaches us and tells us that we're reporting a false positive or a false negative, because we love to run experiments on that stuff and prove them wrong.
Well, okay. So, okay, here's my follow-up question to all that, because that's all great. We need that, right? And we know it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. All testing labs are going to have to operate in this manner, right? And be regulatory compliant and operate in high standards. So while y'all are doing that right now, and as we know, the market's flooded with, you know, all kinds of different players, whether they're good actors or a lot of bad, like, what is the feedback with some of your clients, your customers, you know, as you're doing this? Like, I mean, has there been some like non-returning because you're just doing the right thing and they want higher levels? And I mean, what does that look like?
That's an excellent question. A really good question, Kevin. So we have, you know, we see, I guess you could just say split down the middle. I don't want to say it's 50-50 or whatever, but you know, we see a large area of the community that wants to do the right thing. But we also see a large area of the community that, you know, wants to maintain their investment and do whatever it takes to maintain that. So we have clients that are very loyal, that trust what we're doing and trust the skills and the expertise that we have in here. And they stick with us. They appreciate and trust our analytics. So then what they're doing is they're taking their Delta 8 products and diluting them down into compliant products. So lower potency products, gummies and edibles and things like that. We have other clients on the other hand that love our product. We're next day on everything except microbials, which requires cultivation. Love our product. So they send to us for everything except that Delta 8 potency report, because they want to go and buy that somewhere else where they can get a compliant, you know, high potency straight Delta 8 report. So we see that as well. Then we have other clients that have just left altogether. You know, again, you can buy the COA that you want, and that's that. But I will say we've had clients that have left but have returned after dealing with these labs, these other labs that are target reporting and that are selling COAs. They begin dealing with these labs, not only for their Delta 8 products, but also for their CBD products. And they're starting to realize on the CBD side of things, like, your analytics do not make any sense at all. So they end up coming back to us. And we see a lot of that, you know, and we're here, we're not going anywhere. And we're always going to be here to serve the community. And we stand behind everything that we do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, then that's a good segue, because that was going to be my next question is like, what is next? Like, I guess for specifically Delta 8 is, I guess it's just like stay the course and ride this wave, because it seems at the federal level that they're talking about, you know, federal legalization. I think that other things will come first, obviously banking and, you know, removing that tax provision 280E. But like, I don't think that there's going to be any kind of reform or policy specifically targeting Delta 8. You know, if the federal government's talking about full-blown legalization at some point.
Yeah, I'm not sure. No idea. And I guess it sort of depends on, you know, the Controlled Substance Act does not specifically state Delta 8. But, you know, depending on who you talk to, some may say, well, there is some language in there around Delta 8, some broad language, and then others say, well, you know, not necessarily. So everything is subject to interpretation, right? At the end of the day. But I think descheduling of Delta 9 specifically, yeah, it will really have no bearing on Delta 8, because Delta 8 is essentially a different compound.
That loophole, gotta love that loophole.
you know.
Natalie, I'm going to give you a magic wand, okay? And you flick this wand, and it's a perfect world where there's regulatory compliance for testing labs. What does that look like? What does that lab look like? How does it operate in your perfect world?
In a perfect world. Well, you know, there's several things I can pitch here. You know, but 100 minds are better than one. So this would be something that I would want to collaborate with my colleagues on. So this is a tough question, you know, honestly, but I think that obviously accreditation is going to be important. And more specifically, I think that if we had some, you know, a government body that we were required to register with and that they would come in. So for example, in patient testing, you know, you can have your third party private accreditations, which is what ISO is essentially in the cannabis industry, but also required in patient testing and forensics are government regulations. So in patient testing, you know, Medicare and CLIA and the state, actually some states actually have to come in and inspect. So in the state of Tennessee, CLIA is going to come in and inspect, which is the federal level. The state of Tennessee Medical Laboratory Board is going to come in and inspect. And then on top of that, a physician's going to want to see the third party private accreditation of your testing as well. So honestly, I would like to see it kind of go that way. I would like to see, you know, a cannabis equivalent of CLIA come in and, you know, inspect us, and also the state as well. You know, I just think that, you know, at this point, the only inspections that are happening in the cannabis world, number one, they're not required. Number two, it's just private. So you're doing it as to make your business better, but none of it is required. So there needs to be requirement at the state and probably the federal level too, for registration, licensure, and annual inspection by those government bodies. That's what I would like to see.
Mm-hmm. No, that's a great answer. I totally agree. There's got to be some kind of accountability, right? Someone needs to come in and make sure that you know these labs are operating in high standards and remaining compliant, you know, because it's kind of the wild, wild west out there right now. Yeah. So, hey, Natalie, I want to give you the floor and leave the audience with your final thoughts.
My final thoughts. Well, you know, I anticipate the cannabis industry and community to continue to grow, and I anticipate it to get more sophisticated. I'm a believer. I believe. I'm optimistic. You know, I don't want the community to shy away from the industry because of the lack of regulation and because of the inconsistency in this right now. It's kind of a mess, but you know, every industry is always going to start somewhere, right? And it will grow. And I think that this industry will grow too. And John and I, you know, it is so important to us to continue to lobby for, you know, what's best in this industry and what's going to make it more sophisticated and what's going to make it more regulated, because, you know, that is going to serve the community better than anything else. And the goal is to serve the community here from the growing and manufacturing side all the way to the consumer side. We want everybody to be safe, and we want this to be lucrative as well. So that's why we're here. That's why John and I did this project, and we're not going anywhere, and we're going to continue down this path and continue to lobby for the community.
Very well said. I want to live in Natalie's perfect world. So
I'm a believer.
It's good. We have to be, you know, and you know, I think you're totally right. You know, we want to be doing the right thing in this industry and raise the bar, you know?
Absolutely.
So, well, thank you so much for your time, Natalie. I, you know, learned a lot today. I know the audience learned a lot. Where can people find New Bloom Labs, your website, social media, if they want to learn more and follow y'all?
Yeah, so newbloomlabs.com, that's our website. Through that website, you can print out sample intake forms, figure out how to send samples to us. You can also request a kit from us. So we will actually send you a kit with everything you need to collect your samples and send to us. We make it super easy. We're on Facebook, New Bloom Labs. Follow us there. Always got a lot going on there. And, you know, as always, pick up the phone and call or come in and visit. We love visitors here as well. So Chattanooga.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much again, Natalie. Really appreciate it. And thank you all for listening. Bye.